thank you, I come before your word. May the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight. And we give you liberty of spirit, Lord, as your word goes forth. May it go forth in demonstration of its power and authority. And Father God, that whatever needs to be done here this morning, corporately or individually, have your holy way. So I give you my mouth, I give you my tongue, I give you my lips, I give you my heart to and put ears on the hearts of the church to hear what the Spirit is saying this morning. Mm-hmm. In the name of Yeshua, HaMashiach. Amen. Amen. So I want to have to start off with a little bit of interaction here this morning. And there's two songs that I want brought through the sermon, something a little different, but please take note of the lyrics of the songs and only sing them if you mean them. Because at this time and everything, words are very powerful, and it's what your heart attitude is before God. Hallelujah. So a little bit of interaction here this morning, and you can either say yes or don't say anything or say no. Hallelujah. So, do you believe that Yeshua, HaMashiach, died on the cross just for you and 3 days later rose again? Do you believe that?
Yes.
Right. Do you believe that Yeshua, HaMashiach, is the Son of the living God?
Yes.
Do you believe that the Bible is the Word of God to be the way, the truth, and the life?
Yes.
Do you believe we are into the end of end times?
Yes.
Do you believe we are close to the rapture?
Yes.
Do you believe that we are the generation waiting for the wedding celebration?
Yes.
If you all believe, you've got to be in one of two places right now. Are you ready? Or are you preparing to get ready? I'm so glad we're all here this morning that we agree with those six statements. And where we have unity, we can command the blessing. So, before I start this word, I want us to sing this song. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. And if you wouldn't mind standing while we sing it.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a prepare me. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a
sanctuary, pure and holy, thanksgiving, Lord.
With thanksgiving.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'll be yours.
Faith in Yeshua is the rock of our salvation. In all that he stands for, in all of his teachings, and we live our lives accordingly, that we allow Yeshua to guide our hearts. This is what we've been talking about all morning. It's been coming up about the hearts. In his righteousness, and only his righteousness, and his mercy and grace is new every morning. Then and only then are we free, and Yeshua HaMashiach in us, he is the living hope that lives within us. And he tells us that in 1 Corinthians 3:16-17, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy. Which temple are you? Are you prepared, or are you ready to be prepared? That is the question. So if this is the case, are we so full of mercy? Are we so full of love? Are we so full of joy? Are we so full of shalom? And that's all very good and that's awesome. But all of that takes maintenance. Because we are living in a depraved and corrupt world. But isn't it so wonderful to know that Yeshua HaMashiach has overcome the world? And when we fall short, 1 John 1:9 promises us, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Psalm 37 gives us a couple of good promises here. Psalm 37, 1-7. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land, and this is so important, feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord. Trust in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as a light, and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. And verses 3 and 4 tells us to feed on his faithfulness. As one of God's kids, we must actively and consciously trust that God's word is true and that he always acts in accordance with it. You know, every situation we encounter is an opportunity to choose to trust in the Lord.
Absolutely.
Rather than our own feelings or our own emotions. Faith involves an element of risk sometimes. And faith looks like that. Outside the box, so to speak. We need to consciously commit all our plans to the Lord daily. Do not presume his help if it is uninvited. So let's feed on his wonderful promises. Deuteronomy 7 verse 9 tells us that, know that the Lord your God, he is faithful. For he is faithful for 1,000 generations. Mm-hmm. And here are some promises of God's faithfulness. In Psalm 89:14, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne, but love and faithfulness go before you. Mm-hmm. Proverbs 3:3, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your hearts. Here's the hearts again. Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. John 14:1. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. This is the demand that Yeshua makes to his disciples, to personally trust him. This trust must come from the heart and not the head. It's always a heart matter where Yeshua is concerned. You know, in Jeremiah 17:9-10, the heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked, who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind. Even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. These two verses are not everybody's favorite verses of Scripture, but they teach us how God sees us and is aware of all of our motives, good or bad, our desires, our ideas, the way we want to manage things in our hearts and minds that work together to give an end result. And we've done that a wee bit in Proverbs this morning, didn't we? But when the Spirit gets involved with the heart and the mind, we see we had a discussion about that all this morning. We're all right on. Bringing enlightenment and illumination to the simplicity of joy and peace that will motivate confidence in you to move and have your being, which helps us to understand ourselves in a relationship with Abba Father, Yeshua, and Holy Spirit. Jeremiah states that the human heart can be the most deceitful thing in the whole world.
Yep.
While I was seeking the Lord about this scripture, I thought about Hitler. What sort of heart did he have? I shudder to think. A man without love for others, a heart that has the power to kill men, women, and children. Hamas, who have a similar heart or worse, people in gangs, and people like me. My heart used to be so hard towards God. Christians, Mormons, JWs, anything that had a tag with Jesus or God connected to it. I used to think they were just weak, useless people who needed a crutch. You know, I'm a Kiwi macho man. I can look after myself and my family. I don't need no one or anything else. And that was the culture of the orphanage. But they used to talk about God and that at Sunday school when I was in there, but when you got back home and you couldn't see what they were talking about, and they say to me they were just a bunch of hypocrites. Until the 2nd of May, which was just last Thursday gone. 1991, 8:30 that night in our lounge at Foxton Beach. In a matter of about 3 and 5 minutes, God broke through all my resistance. 33 years ago on Thursday that happened. And I'm still pinching myself. Here I am. Bringing the word.
Good one.
Hey, look what God has done. I got to give him the glory. God is still working in my heart even now and my mind. You know, is it a lie if someone comes up to me and says, "How are you today, Ron?" And I reply, "Oh, I'm cool, man. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm feeling good." And I answer, "Yeah, praise the Lord, I'm feeling good." Now, is the Lord searching my heart? Or is he testing my mind? He is doing both, because the heart and the mind were working together until the Spirit comes in. See what happens when the Spirit comes in. "How are you today, Ron?" "Well, I could do with a little bit of prayer." "Really? What a difference a prayer makes. Why suffer?" You know, it's quite interesting. In chapter 18, over the page, the Lord tells Jeremiah to go down to the potter's house. So let's read from verses 1 to 6. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words." Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was, making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, "O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter, says the Lord? Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." Now, can we paraphrase verse 6 to say, "O sanctuary of Ron," put your name, own name, where Israel is. "Can I not do with you as this potter says, the Lord, says the Lord? Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O sanctuary of Ron." Mm-hmm. Good one. Just stay seated and sing the song. And look at the potter and put your heart on the wheel.
Change my heart, oh God.
make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the Potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God.
Come change my heart.
Make it ever true.
Make it ever true.
Change my heart, oh God.
Come change my heart.
May I be like you. You are the Potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Well, that was a lovely song. So is God starting to change your hearts already?
Absolutely.
Hallelujah. Is he allowed to be the Potter?
Amen.
So you just remember that as soon as we give our heart to Yeshua, a relationship starts with a potter. And Isaiah 64 verse 8 tells us, "But now, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you our potter, and all we are the work of your hand." This work of your hand. First, the potter chooses a lump of clay before he can start. Reminds me of John 15:16. You did not choose me, but I chose you. Before the potter starts, he has a special idea or a picture in his mind. He wants to make a hymn out of you. So God has a plan and a purpose for each one of us. When the potter puts this lump of clay on the wheel, it has to be dead center. Otherwise, the clay will get all wobbly and will be all just mucked up. So we must have Yeshua as the center of our lives, the dead center, so to speak, dying to self. Galatians 2:20 tells us that I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And he who, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. The potter, you notice, dips his hand in the bowl of water regularly to make it easier to form the clay into how he wants it to look. Ephesians 5:26-27 tells us that he might sanctify you and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present her to himself, that's the potter, a gracious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. As we surrender to the potter's hand, which is soft and yet firm, and to shape us and mold us, and sometimes it hurts a little bit and it can be a bit painful. But James 1 warns us about in verses 2 and 3, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. Another word there is steadfast. But right through the whole process, he never takes his eyes off you. He has nothing else on his mind. His focus is totally on what he is creating, loving and enjoying watching the vessel taking its near finished work. One thing, when it's God doing the work, there's no whoopses. Let's have a look in Romans 9. Romans 9, 20 to 24. But instead, O man, who are you to reply against God? Will the thing formed say to him, who formed it? Why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have the power over the clay? For the same lump of for the same lump to make one vessel for honor and others for dishonor. What if God wants to show his wrath and to make his power known? Endured with much long-suffering, the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction. When you think of that, you think of why Judas Iscariot, you know. That's why God created him, as a vessel for wrath. And that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had prepared beforehand for glory. Even us, whom he called, not of the Jew only, but also the Gentile. You know, if I'm that slab of clay on the potter's wheel, am I ready to yield to the potter's hand and trust him and to what he needs to do in the process? Isaiah 42 verse 9 tells us, behold, the former things have come to pass. A new thing I declare before they spring forth. I tell you of them. And 1 Thessalonians 5, 23, 24 tells us, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul and body be presented blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who called you is faithful, who also will do it. You know, Yeshua is really hungry for our personal fellowship this morning. And today it was mentioned something about fellowshipping with him and the words that came forth. Since I've been working on this message, three times it happened to me. I'd be watching something good on TV and the Holy Spirit would ask me, would you come and spend some time with me? The first time I hummed and hawed a bit, but I turned the TV off and just spent some quiet time with him and got blessed. The second and third time he asked me, I didn't hesitate. When he asked me, who I believe was a test of obedience. So when God speaks to you to spend time with him, believe me, don't hum or ha. And it won't be inconvenient when you finish, when he's finished having fellowship with you. God wants to have more of you. Hebrews chapter 12. Verses 25 to 29. See that you do not refuse him who speaks. For if they do not escape who refuses him who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more, I shake not only the earth, but also heaven. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken, as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a God of restoration. God wants to restore back what has been stolen. I believe God wants to shake off the work of man and the works of Satan. I believe that there is going to be a divine restoration, and it will begin with you and me. There's some stuff that needs to go, and we've got to shake it off and let go. God has been in the restoration business since Genesis, and the Holy Spirit is going to hover again and shake the works of man's hands. What's of the world, so that divine restoration can begin, especially the entire concept of the Holy Spirit. God created man in his own image, male and female, and man enjoyed the image of God, the intimacy, the unbroken fellowship with God. But man decided to take things and put them in his own hands by eating the forbidden fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. In doing that, he decided to put his own life in his own hands instead of living from the resources of God, in wisdom and righteousness of God. He wanted to live from his own limited resources. Man lost his intimacy and his continuous fellowship with the Lord, his creator, the potter. But God went into restoration mode straight away. But man tried to cover his nakedness by sewing some fig leaves together to cover themselves. But God, in his restoring love, required the innocent blood of a lamb that he had made to be sacrificed. So he provided Adam and Eve with the garments from the skin of the lamb, and God started his redemption plan and restoration plan for all mankind. That the first sacrifice provided clothing. The second lamb God sent his son as the ultimate sacrificial lamb, Yeshua HaMashiach. Now we are about to enter the ultimate restoration, the return of the church, the bride of Yeshua HaMashiach, to the majesty and the glory of God, I believe God is releasing His power and purity without measure through the church, so that the unshakable kingdom will be revealed. On Hebrews 12, 28 and 29, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. I love what verse 29 says. Our God is a consuming fire. It's not by might, it's not by power, but by my Spirit. At Pentecost, tongues of fire sat on each person's head. There was a corporate but also a personal visitation to the mind and hearts of every person present. The fire came not to consume them, for no one was injured. The fire gives light, but fire gives more than just light. It inflames us, and those flames that inflame us, that sat upon each person, became a blaze of love and intense zeal, and burning with self-sacrifice. May our prayer be, Lord, may that fire that burns within destroy all my sin as a burnt offering unto our Father, that never dying flame of zeal for you and the total devotion to the cross of Yeshua. Ephesians 5:25-27. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the water of the word, that he might present her to himself a gracious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So, let's open up our hearts and allow the hand of the potter to begin. As the song says, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. Do you know why he wants to prepare you? He wants to prepare you for a life in eternity.
Thank you.
Amen.